I noticed many of the conference rooms around here have people's names on it. Right now we're in the Mackey room for John Mackey, who, you know, the Whole Foods CEO and co-founder. I see Bezos across the way here. What's the theme here?
So we definitely love entrepreneurs. There are no great stocks. There are no great stock picks without great entrepreneurs.
Right.
So while we're very stock market focused, the truth is we're just very business focused. So I want to make it really clear that we deeply admire and are grateful for people like Jeff Bezos. I'm glad that I got to live on the earth at the time that Jeff did. Not only did we pick the stock at $3 a share, and now it's like 2,000, so it's up 600 times in value, so it's been our best stock pick ever. So not only do we appreciate that, but apart from any bragging, what an incredible company Amazon is. I mean, how much value is that? Just for me as a consumer, maybe you too.
Yes.
And then right next to it, Rowling, J.K. Rowling. What an incredible entrepreneur. I mean, the author of the Harry Potter book.
It just made my daughter very happy, incidentally.
And you know what I love about both Rowling and Bezos? Think about the smiles they brought to how many lives in totally different ways. And yet both of them, very business-minded. J.K. Rowling, I think the highest net worth, except for maybe Queen Elizabeth, female in the U.K. today. And think about where she came from. In fact, both Bezos and Rowling didn't come from wealth.
Right.
And so that's also a great story, and always been true, will be true every generation about business, is that entrepreneurs rise from anywhere.
Yep, and it's a story of wealth creation, right? And that's what I think people have to understand, is that wealth is created through efforts, through purpose, through these types of productive activities. It's value creation.
That's exactly right. In fact, the way I've heard it before, and Patrick, I bet you know this because it sounds very familiar, is poverty doesn't need to be explained.
Right.
Because poverty is how everything started.
Right.
We arose from the swamps. We didn't even have clothes. Poverty doesn't need to be explained. Maybe in some contexts it does.
Yeah.
Really what needs to be explained is our wealth, our prosperity. Where did that come from? And how do we get more of that? How do we generate more of that for everybody globally?
So aside from these conference rooms, I'm seeing this open area work environment here that's fascinating to say the least. It looks like fun. I want to go out and play.
Well, it's funny you mentioned that, Patrick, because in some ways, both my brother, our CEO, Tom Gardner, and his brother, Dave Gardner, have sometimes wondered, is this the most productivity that we could have, this kind of approach? Because it is fun. It's very social. There's a lot of glass, a lot of transparency, which is true of the Motley Fool's advice and our brand and how we've always built our company. But it also means sometimes it's almost too fun. So some of our employees have to sequester themselves sometimes in quiet spaces or dark places to actually get work done here at Fool HQ. I don't come in every day of the week now these days at the Fool, but when I do, I'm here for meetings. I stack my meetings wall to wall across the day. If I actually needed to be picking my stocks or do other things, I might need to find some quiet spaces outside of Fool HQ. Anyway, it is a lot of fun and we love it.
Now, you earlier alluded to saying people don't understand what the term invest means. So can we circle back to that and tell me what you mean by that statement?
Yeah, so the word invest comes from the Latin investere. Mm-hmm. And I never did take Latin, but I do love etymologies. I do love seeing where our language comes from. So the word investere in Latin means to put on the clothes of, to wear the clothes of. So a word like priestly vestments, that's from the same root investere. So to wear the clothes of. And I love that visual for trying to teach others truly how to invest. Because I think it's a lot closer. We're about to hit the NFL football time of year. So if you're a fan, you go to the games, people are wearing the jerseys of the teams, or hockey. Happens especially in hockey and football. It seems not as much baseball. Baseball. Anyway, people are wearing the clothes. And that's the way we think you should be with your money when you're investing in great companies.
Right.
You should love what the company does. You should see something of yourself in it. You should be patient. When your team has a losing streak, you shouldn't sell. And you shouldn't be right away thinking, now that I've bought this stock, when do I sell?
Right.
You should basically be making a lifetime of it as a fan of capitalism and of the companies that you're invested in. So that's where the word invest comes from, to put on the clothes of. And we live in a world where the average mutual fund today turns over 70 to 100% of itself over the course of a year. So the average managed mutual fund today, whatever the managers start with January 1st, those stocks are typically gone by the end of that same year. And while that might work for the institutions, although I don't think it's a great approach for institutions, it certainly shouldn't be done by individuals. We have an incredible advantage by showing patience and by putting on those clothes.
Well, it's interesting because the context of that word is used that way, like I'm invested in my team, you know, the New York Giants, you know.
You're right.
And that's why you would, because you know, you're emotionally invested, you know, and why? Because there's something about that that reflects, you said this, so I'm just reiterating, but there's something about that you see there that reflects something in yourself that you connect to that, that you want to be bonded with. So does that translate into more, like you're saying, like a long-term kind of view when you're investing or buying stock that you don't want to just turn things over, but what you advise people as a part of your investment philosophy is to buy and hold or be invested in it for the long haul. How do you see that?
That's right. I see that as the greatest advantage that you and I have as individuals, and it's more powerful mm-hmm. than the institutions. Institutions really have to trade in and out, in part because they have a lot of people who are putting money in the fund and then need to pull it out to buy a house or whatever. So institutions themselves mm-hmm. are jumping in and out, partly driven by individuals. But you and I, with our own portfolios, our 401k plans, there's no compulsion to do that. We should be investing toward retirement or toward goals that should be long-term goals. And so the greatest friend to us is the power of compounded returns. Mm-hmm. But I mean, it's just such an incredibly, the math is so beautiful. The stock market on average returns about 10% annualized. Mm-hmm. I don't know of anything else that does that. I mean, that is literally every year it goes up another 10%. Now, you and I both know it's not literally every year. Some years it drops 28%, and other years it goes up 42%. But when you take it on average mm-hmm. over decades or now century plus, it's 10% a year. And so if you just let that 10% keep compounding, mm-hmm. you know that you start to double your money every 7 years. And that's just if you're doing what the stock market on average does. Now, every day at the Motley Fool, I and my fellow fools work to beat the market averages. I'm happy to say we have a record of doing that. So we can actually double our money faster than that. But there's nothing like that. So the earlier anybody watching this show finds out about that in life, as early as possible, they get on that train, the compounding train, that 10% annualized, wind at your back. And it's so powerful 10, 20, 50 years later. That's why it's a delight whenever I can talk to a teenager. Mm-hmm. And when I'm talking to a 52-year-old like myself, I still feel great. Like, I hope we got another 50 years, so let's stay invested. But the earlier we can get them through all the work that we're doing together, the better for them.
So it's obvious for the younger person saying, hey, you know, there's a lot of road in front of you, and it'd be good to take advantage of this now. But let's say you're the 50-something, as you characterize it, professional. Mm-hmm. You've made a good living, you know, over time, but you've never understood investment, never understood, you know, you only understood how to create, you know, revenue based on the business that you're in. What advice would you have for them? Say, I'm in my 50s now, how do I jump into this?
Yeah, so number one, a lot of what you learn from your professional life can and should be applied to your investing life. Mm-hmm. And one of the sad things for me, since there's such a lack of financial literacy and understanding in our country, and our country is well ahead of much of the rest of the world.
Sure.
So there's just mass ignorance about how to make your money work for you. Mm-hmm. But once you realize that the lessons you learn as a professional can be applied, like what companies do you admire? Great, let's buy those companies in our portfolios. Mm-hmm. Let's be numerical. We have to be that in our business. Well, did you know that whole 10% thing I was talking about earlier? Let's do some math on a spreadsheet together and put together a plan. And let's so number one, you have more than you think, which was the title of our second book. Mm-hmm. All those lessons and viewpoints you have, both as a professional and a consumer.
Right.
And the people around you. Some of my best stocks come from my kids, mm-hmm. my wife, my friends, my fellow fools. I don't have to be a genius and find every good company out there. I can definitely listen and socialize mm-hmm. it, right? So number one. Then number two, you know, we're all living longer these days. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people have the biggest fear, not that they didn't save, but that they're gonna live so long that they're gonna outlive and outstrip their savings because of the increase in longevity. Worldwide, longevity for humans is up 1/3 in the last, since 1950. So basically the last 80 years, we're all living 1/3 longer than they did just a generation or two ago. So, as a fellow early 50s person, if I'm speaking to somebody like me, because I'm 52, I'd say you should be thinking about 40 years ahead. Does that sound like a long amount of time? To me, that sounds like the long term. That sounds like a good, healthy amount of time. So let's get invested now. Let's take our savings right away and get it in the market. And we can talk some about the market and its wiles. But, you know, let's not worry about what the market's going to do tomorrow. Let's not worry about people telling you it's going to crash next year, those kinds of things. think about being an investor for the rest of your life, 40 plus years, and let's start doing it the real way, the way that works.
So let's talk about the market. So what comments did you have in your mind when you were saying, yeah, we can talk about the market? What do you want to say about it?
So a couple of rules of thumb everybody should know. We've already covered one. Mm-hmm. Stock market rises on average 10% a year. It's very hard to find anything that's going to do that. Real estate, depending on where we are, might do something like that, but it's illiquid. Mm-hmm. You can't turn around and sell that property. And sometimes you have to maintain or be a landlord. That's a lot of effort relative to just a stock portfolio. Bonds, 5, 6, 7% historically. Mm-hmm. CDs, 1, 2% historically. I mean, so the state lottery minus 50%. I have to put a quick slam into the state lottery because it's really bad advice that we're giving our fellow Americans every day. Things like you got to play to win.
Right.
You could be next. It's really sad. Every dollar that anybody spends on a lottery ticket, 50 cents is skimmed right off the top as a tax, and you're left with an incredibly, it's a bear market every day in state right. lottery. So people lack an understanding of these numbers, and so I just like to make sure we understand kind of the range of possibilities. There's minus 50% daily, mm-hmm. right up to, how about 10% annually? Over time. So another rule of thumb, 2 years out of every three, the stock market rises. 1 year out of every three, the stock market drops. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to hold, as I do for decades, that means a third of the time you're going to feel bad. Mm-hmm. You're going to look silly. As a professional picking stocks that people follow my advice, I look like an idiot all the time. A lot of the stocks that I picked haven't worked out. Mm-hmm. And so you just have to be at peace with that and recognize you need to lose to win.